Stockholm, I love you more than all the others. So I salute you, my Swedish brother.
Phil would take someone in his life or himself and just, he'd write a song around it. It would be kind of a kind of, it would be veiled, but not completely veiled. It would be transparent. You could see who he was on about. Like, you know, Parisian Walkways. It wasn't about Paris, it was about him. I remember Paris in 49. He was born in 49. His middle name's Paris. Things like that. He was always very clever in that way.
You are the only one I know who's been in a band and still says that the band, Thin Lizzy in this case, was better off without you, with a different lineup.
Well, what I meant was that the classic lineup of the band was kind of everyone's favourite. And it was kind of, I mean, I liked that lineup of the band better because it meant I could go and see them, and I quite liked listening to the records like Jailbreak and all that stuff. And I just thought it worked better with Brian and Scott on guitar. It was just a more kind of sympathetic sort of chemistry between them. So, you know, it wasn't me being like falsely modest or anything, or saying that there were better guitarists than me or anything like that. I wasn't saying that, I just meant that as a band, I felt that it was better that way.
Okay.
But he was forgetting the words of the songs because he was a bit out of it from the night before. We were already having a row on stage by this stage because we started to play one song and it got to the guitar solo and he sung another verse. So I'm going, hey, fuck off, excuse me. And he's gone, no, you fuck off. And the kids at the front are going, you guys suck, you guys are shit. That was the gig. It was a bad night. You know, the overall thing was, it was just like, you know, the parties were becoming more important than the gig. The party after the gig was becoming more important than the gig. And when it gets to that point for me, I'm not interested. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't a good thing that I did, but I felt at the time that was the only way I could deal with it. I was really unhappy going on stage and the band was falling apart for me. You know, I don't want to like put Phil down because I know he had a problem. But for me, it was a nightmare to play live at that point with the band. It was just getting worse from being a super tight band. It was just turning into a bit of a mess, really. And then the last gig was a day at the Green in San Francisco. And it was a huge, you know, the big stadium in Oakland. And he was losing it that day. He kicked the microphone stand over. He was in such, just not flying. And that was the day I left. You know, he went from being like this really energetic workaholic guy. It was a long decline. It didn't just happen overnight. One time he was just full of energy. He'd be the first one up in the morning. He'd be like our mother. He'd be cooking breakfast for us all, you know, and stuff. And he'd be in the studio long after everyone else had finished. And he'd be first in the next day. He'd spend 7 hours doing a rough guide vocal, writing the lyrics as he went along with a big spliff in his mouth and just... That's how he was. He was just full of it. He worked harder than anybody I ever met at that time. Phil came to Ireland when I was doing the Emerald Isles video to sing on Parisian Walkways. We had actually just made up as friends again. We hadn't seen each other, I remember, for 4 years. It was a big thing between us. And I said, do you want to come over and, you know, do this thing at, you know, the Ulster Hall in Belfast? And he said, yeah, yeah. And then I told him about the song Out in the Fields. And I said, do you want to do this together as a single? And he said, yeah, yeah, yeah. So... But Phil was very involved in that whole thing. I mean, I wrote the whole song, but Phil really added a hell of a lot to it in terms of, you know, just having his voice and the whole imagery of the thing. Like, Phil came up with the whole kind of imagery of the, you know, the kind of soldiers' jackets and the whole thing of putting it across in a commercial way. So he was very responsible. I don't think, if I'd recorded that on my own, I don't think it would have been a hit, to be honest.
It doesn't matter if you're wrong or if you're right.
You know, I'm very happy that we were able to do that. Mm. It was an opportunity, our last opportunity as it turned out, to work together. So it was good that we did it. I was in Tenerife and my wife at the time's parents were living there. And her dad, her father told me, oh, your friend's not very well. What do you mean? And he told me he'd read about Phil in the paper, that Phil had been taken to hospital. So I was calling up the office every day to find out what was happening. And then they told me he was getting better. So I suddenly relaxed about it. And I thought, oh yeah. But then I had this bad feeling. And then you get the papers over there a day late So on Monday, we got the Sunday papers, and my wife at the time, she picked it up, she went, and I saw her face, and I knew exactly what had happened. And I'd had this dream the night before about a black cat being strangled, like with a cord around its neck. I had this really bad feeling.